Hi, welcome. I am Harish Khatri and this is my colleague Nagaraju. Today we will be presenting some new PCI device attacks that we have identified in our work on data center platforms. Our team, we are all security researchers working at Intel Corporation, and our team's focus is on looking into security of different technologies at Intel, primarily focusing on data center solutions, looking into features like trusted computing and virtualization. The issues and attacks that we are presenting today, we identified as part of our work in 2019-2020 on some Intel designs. These are the related security advisories with the issues that we had identified. We think these issues are not just specific to particular designs, but generally applicable to any product using PCI devices and switches. So we want to share these learnings and out with the rest of the security community and discuss what kind of mitigations and solutions are available for protecting against these attacks. So in our talk today, we will initially introduce some basic concepts. These may be like refreshers for people who are well familiar with PCIe devices and network. We'll go through the specific threat model and threat analysis that we used in our research, and then switch to discussing specific attacks that we identified. We identified issues in two key areas. One is on PCI switches. These switch devices are something that is have not been looked at as closely as PCI endpoint device in previous security research. So we'll go through specific attacks that we have seen against these, and then we'll discuss beyond PCI switches some specific transactions and messages that PCI standard defines, which can also be used for attacks like denial of service and attacking other components connected on the PCI network. And finally, we'll discuss specific mitigations that are available for protecting against these attacks. So to get started, just some refresher on PCI network, right? So PCI is an industry-defined standard for high-speed data bus that allows peripheral I/O devices to be connected to the CPU complex, right? So this figure here shows a typical PCIe tree where the CPU and memory is connected through a root complex device to a set of PCIe endpoints. So root complex is a key thing that's defined by PCIe standard, which allows such peripherals to be connected to the CPU complex. And in PCIe, you can also obviously have peer-to-peer transactions. So transactions are also going from a PCIe device to another PCIe device, depending on the system configuration and not just between the peripheral and the CPU. The previous work on attacking such PCIe networks has focused on the PCI Express endpoint, where you can design a custom, say, PCIe rogue PCIe device using an FPGA or some other hardware design and plug such a device onto the network and try to attack and access the system memory or attack other resources within the CPU, right? So that has been the traditional focus on using PCI devices, especially hardware PCI attacks. In our work, when we were looking at server platforms, we looked at different components that are there on the board and what sorts of security attacks we can do in it. So one interesting thing we saw is that all the PCI devices are connected through switches. And these switches also have capabilities and controls that can be used to attack the system. So what's a switch in a PCI network, right? So the PCI standard defines these as a logical assembly of multiple virtual PCI to PCI bridges, right? So I think of them like port expanders, right? So they, in case in a server platform, if you have just a limited set of PCI slots, physically to expand it out so that multiple more peripheral devices can be connected to the compute system, such switches are used, right? And they could be in transparent or non-transparent mode, to allow multiple devices to be connected. Same as normal, say, network switches, these switches have to be able to handle routing of the messages and sending transactions between different endpoints and routing them back upstream to the CPU complex. So let's now discuss what threat model we used, right? So since we were focusing on the server platform, we looked at virtualization enabled systems where for the IO peripherals, we looked at devices which have single root IO virtualization enabled, right? In this, what is allowed is that the PCI device, instead of showing up as a single PCI device, shows up as multiple device functions, such that the hypervisor can then assign, say, the key physical function to a management VM or a trusted host OS. And the virtual functions are specific functions that can then be assigned to guest VMs, which have limited resources and capabilities. Right? So this is something that standard SRIOV defines. So in our adversary models, we take a look at like the PCI device itself could be malicious. So it could launch this kind of standard rogue PCI attacks, or the guest VM could be malicious, which has access to the virtual function of the PCI device, and it could launch attack against the host VM, hypervisor, or the PCI device. Similarly, the host OS or the guest host management VM could also be malicious, since it has access to the physical function of the device, and it can, you know, potentially launch attacks against the higher privilege firmware or the PCI firmware or other PCI device peripherals connected in the system. And then there are the standard sort of BIOS or hypervisor attacks or someone physically plugging into the system, right? PCI switches in this model are kind of pass-through devices, which help connect the PCI endpoint to the host software. And PCI switch controls and configurations typically would be managed by either the host OS in this case or the hypervisor. So the attacks that we are focusing or presenting today, let's just discuss what adversary levels are needed for them. So the things that we are discussing related to PCI switches, in a normal configuration, we'd expect those to be exposed to the management VM or the host VM. So we'll discuss these specific three attacks in detail later. And then issues that we identify related to, say, PCI errors, in that case, the attacker can even be the guest VM, which is a lower trusted software module in this design. So to start off discussing our attacks, we will start with the things related to PCI switches. To look into detail of PCI switches, let's just discuss briefly on typically what is there in a PCI switch hardware design. It's supposed to connect multiple PCI devices upstream to a single PCI port. The PCI switch has to be configured and controlled by some software. So it exposes normally the standard PCI config space and MMIO controls up to software, which the hypervisor will manage or it will give to a management VM. The switch also needs some hard-coded configuration settings for the port configuration, PCI-PHY configuration. These are typically either hardware straps or pin straps on the switch, or if they are more extensive, there will be non-volatile storage. So it will have EEPROM to store this. If it's even more complex design, then it can have its own microcontroller in there. So its firmware and patches would also be stored in the same non-volatile storage. So similar to other hardware designs, you would have like debug modes, maybe a JTAG port or software-based debug capabilities to access control these devices. Some variations that we have seen when looking at different PCI switches is that in some cases, the switch also includes a PCI device within itself. So it has a virtual PCI endpoint. So when you plug it through this switch, it comes and shows up as a PCI bridge, but also shows a PCI endpoint. And then some which are more complex can include a programmable microcontroller in it. So to discuss our first attack, we'll look at first thing we looked at when we saw these devices in our reference platforms is to say, okay, can we go and corrupt this device EEPROM, right? So for our switch attacks, we will be using these Broadcom PEX devices as an example, but similar capabilities and issues we have seen in other vendor devices as well, right? So first we try to see how to reprogram this EEPROM and is this accessible from software. So in this particular device's case, the EEPROM programming interface was exposed up to software as MMIO, and the standard sort of registers to control this were exposed. So that's good for us as attack from attack perspective. So then let's look at what is the format of the EEPROM that this device supports. So this was also well documented in the data sheets, and it's standard sort of format of EEPROM. The thing that was interesting to us here was how it is organized. Like, it has a table of address and data values in the EEPROM. So this is something interesting that we have seen in other hardware designs, and it looks like a initial boot time configuration loading, right? So initially the hardware goes and reads this configuration from EEPROM and applies, goes to this address and writes this data. So at boot time you can go and reconfigure the device. So this is a good way to kind of roundabout way to write into the internal registers and controls of the switch. So that was interesting. So we started digging more deeper into it, dumped the EEPROM, and it's the standard sort of initial first byte is a signature, then size count of how many bytes there are, and last four bytes are CRC. And you can kind of extend this out to add more address and data writes into the switch controls. And the switch has different register offsets and controls exposed. And so you pick the right offset and write the right data. So you can reprogram the whole configuration of the switch this way. And it's, this is exposed to software. So it's kind of a different or new way to write into the registers that the switch exposes that's outside of the PCI defined sort of PCI config read write or MMIO read writes. So our interest was obviously to try to attack this EEPROM and corrupt it. So first thing, we just tried to see if this works. So we took the standard PCI config space registers and modified them through this mechanism to see if this works. So initially just tried to change the revision ID, which is usually like a non-destructive register that you can modify and check. So yeah, this works. We can actually change the revision ID of the device. So then we tried something more destructive, right? So we have a set of devices on our platform connected through this switch, and we modified the switch's device ID and vendor ID to be all Fs. So what would this result in, right? So if a PCI device is connected and it boots up and reports its device ID and vendor ID as all Fs, then what is the system response? So what happens in PCI is that device ID and vendor ID of all Fs is defined as an invalid vendor ID device ID. So the PCI device stops enumerating. And the interesting thing is, since this is a PCI switch, anything that is connected through the switch, that also stops enumerating and doesn't show up in the software, either at the BIOS or any level in the system. So this was interesting because this works pretty well as a persistent DOS attack, because any device that was connected through this switch, once we have misconfigured the EEPROM, now the EEPROM is no longer accessible because the PCI switches management interface is also gone, and the device is corrupted in the EEPROM. So even if you reboot the machine, the attack is persistent and stays across reset. Somebody can like physically go and reprogram the device, but in a data center, that's a very costly fix. And these devices could have I2C or other ports through which they connect to BMC that are potentially usable for recovery. But through the same mechanism, like we corrupted the PCI interface, you can also misconfigure the I2C or other ports and disable those. So these we identified in some solutions where this programmable EEPROM and this DOS attack was working, and these are the CVEs related to that, right? So again, this is not something specific to a particular implementation. Any device using a switch could be potentially vulnerable to such an attack. So for going beyond this, we looked at, okay, what else can we do by attacking these devices, right? So our target really was to use these devices, since they are connecting multiple PCI devices, to try to see if we can use these devices to attack the normal sort of rogue PCI device attacks, right? So in order to launch the normal rogue PCI devices, you have to, one key capability you need to look for is to be able to inject your own arbitrary PCIe packets, right? So PCIe standard defines transaction layer packets as the main kind of communication messages, which define what is the type of transaction, size of transaction, which address it is going to, what device it's going to. So being able to manipulate these packets directly in a raw frame is very useful for an attacker. So we wanted to see if this can be done in the switches. So in a general design, we would expect something like this to be there for testing purposes. Like you're testing the PCI initially for maybe the physical properties of the link and making sure reliability is there or debugging. So we thought this would be something that maybe that is there in a debug mode and maybe not necessarily exposed to software. But let's look into this device. So again, we'll take PEX device as an example. So it does come with a full-blown PCI packet injector with its own kind of software development kit also available. So the steps and things to this are kind of partially documented. They're not fully documented feature of exactly how the injector works. But looking into their packet generator and from the SDK details of exactly how they're programming it, we were able to figure out, like, okay, there's a sequence of writes through a MMIO register, which allows you to insert a PCI frame byte by byte into internal SRAM, which is then programmed, and then there's a packet injector that you can program and script to say how many times you have to inject this packet, if you want to put any delays or reset the machine. So you can script it and send a PCI frame multiple times through this packet injector, and you can program it in raw bytes. So this is a pretty strong sort of debug capability. The interesting thing was also that this one was enabled in hardware, and for this particular design, you couldn't even disable it. Like, there's no EEPROM configuration or software control to be able to disable this injector. And we confirmed this being enabled in a few devices, and these are CVEs related to those, right? Now, what is the impact of this debug capability being exposed, right? So software can obviously inject these raw TLP frames and use that as a rogue PCI attack launcher to other components. So one question that can be raised here is to say, hey, you already, in order to control this through MMIO, you need to be a host VM. So from host OS perspective, you already have very high privilege on the system. So what else can you compromise, right? So that's where, let's look at what other things can we do, right? So system memory and DMA attacks on PCIe, those are known, and then we are coming in from host OS, so you already have that access. So what else can we do, right? So in PCIe, it defines different types of transactions, right? So since we have raw PCI packet injection capability here, now memory read, memory write, IO read, IO write, those kind of transactions, a lot of things have been looked at there for rogue PCI attacks. But we looked at messages. This is an area that's not as well looked into in security research. Right. So PCI also defines support for messages. These are used for management component transport protocol. This is a protocol for exchanging manageability messages. Right. So typically in a server platform, you'd see this is the network of MCTP, and pretty much all the components like CPU, SSDs, network, graphics, FPGA, and base baseboard management controller, BMC, is connected. So other than the host OS, these components have their own trust boundaries. Like BMC wouldn't allow the host OS to compromise its firmware. So host OS can use these messages to then try to launch an attack against other components on the platform. And what's more, the MCTP protocol itself doesn't provide any security mechanisms. There are higher layer protocols like SPDM, which are being defined by DMTF, which add support for secure messaging. But in at least current generation is not fully enabled. And at least the MCTP layer is still going to be unprotected. So you can send these messages to multiple receivers. So this here shows a typical MCTP packet, which is encapsulated into a PCIe TLP, right? So this is the kind of packets that you could potentially inject into the network using a raw PCIe injector and spoof like the MCTP IDs or sizes or other parameters, right? So typically, normal sort of malicious packet injection attacks can be launched. And we looked at what kind of reference MCTP receivers are available on server platforms and what sort of attacks we can do against them, right? And we have confirmed issues against receivers. Like one example is on OpenBMC firmware, where we could send fragmented MCTP frames to corrupt BMC memory and overflow into their memory. So that way be able to privilege escalate from rogue PCI device attack into the BMC firmware using MCTP PCI messages. So in the next section, we'll continue looking at other PCIe messages, mainly errors that can be used to launch attacks. And for this section, I'll hand it over to my friend Nagaraju. Thanks.
Thank you, Harish. Thanks for the overview. In this section, we are going to cover the different PCIe errors in the context of SROV capable devices that we went and looked at and see what kind of attacks we can realize. Before we get into the actual attack scenario, let me quickly go over the couple of error signals that are possible to generate using a PCIe device. One type of error messages can be through a completion TLP as a response to a request coming from the host. And the other type of error signals are through message TLP, which is initiated from the device based on certain error conditions that may occur on the platform. And what you see here is there is a fatal error, which is of a message type, which when generated from a PCIe device, the expectation is that the host platform will typically result in a platform shutdown or a reboot. That is what the spec says. And now, in the context of SROV capable device, we have something called Advanced Error Reporting or AER. These are type of error configurations that are made available in SROV capable device. And in general, the PCIe supports two types of error classifications. As you see, one is correctable error, other one is the uncorrectable error. Correctable errors are, as the name indicates, are soft errors. They can be managed. Whereas uncorrectable errors are something which are critical by nature. And even there, we have two types of uncorrectable errors. One is non-fatal and the other one is fatal. Non-fatal is more like a warning, whereas fatal errors are something that must be handled and should be addressed by the host. And in an uncorrectable fatal error situation, the PCIe endpoint will send a fatal error to the root complex. In addition, the host side, we also get some support to control the behavior of the PCIe endpoint devices with the help of two important registers that we want to call out. One is the uncorrectable error mask register. The other one is uncorrectable error severity register. These two, when appropriately used by the host software, can control the behavior of the PCIe device. However, when a fatal error condition is occurring on the device, it is the responsibility of the platform software to manage it appropriately. And in our research, we looked at both this combination of uncorrectable fatal error as well as the register configuration. Now, what we want to discuss is SROV capable devices are very much used in the data centric usages today, like Ethernet controllers, FPGA devices, storage controllers, etc., and Intel has been shipping products in this space. And we looked into some of the SRIVOA capable devices and devised some attack scenarios as listed here. There are two major attack scenarios that one can think of. In the first attack scenario, a malicious VM or VF, as Aris explained earlier, can attack other VMs or the host, the PF driver, through some of the interfaces it has. And we have found such vulnerabilities and the respective CVEs are listed. What we want to showcase in today's presentation is the attack scenario number two, where a malicious VF or a VM abuses its own hardware resources to cause the platform DOS, which is an expensive attack in a data center world. And how does that attack look like? So what happens is a rogue VM or attacker VM can trigger some of the illegal transactions like illegal MMIO transaction or a malformed TLP and so on, which eventually will result in a PCIe error on the endpoint SRIVOV device. As a response, the VF or the SRIVOV device will send a response back saying there exists a PCIe error for the transaction, which happens to be a fatal error in the exploit that we want to demonstrate later. And when such error happens, the expectation is on the host side, it will result in a CPU machine check, which eventually bring down the platform and causes a reboot. And now we are going to watch a 2-minute video, which will showcase how we demonstrated that attack on our Ethernet control device.
Hi, in this demo, we will demonstrate a platform DOS attack from an SRIOV VF driver. SRIOV VF driver is managed by a guest VM in a virtualization environment, hence consider untrusted software on the platform. So let's start the demo by opening a host VMM terminal. From the host terminal, first we will run the SRIOV setup script. This script will set up all the necessary configurations for the SRIOV hardware to function correctly. Next, we will start a guest VM using the Virtualization Manager. This is the VM from which we will launch the attack. Now we will run our exploit script from the VM terminal. If the attack is successful, it should cause the platform to reboot. Now as you can see, the platform is starting to reboot. So we have successfully demonstrated that by exploiting a vulnerability in the SRIOV hardware, untrusted software in the guest VM could cause a platform DOS. This concludes our demo. Thank you for watching.
Coming to in the next section, as we watch the video to go through the exploit demo, in the next section, I am going to summarize the overall attack scenarios and the mitigations associated with different attack scenarios that Harish and myself have presented. In the first section, we discussed about the PCIe switches and what kind of attacks are possible. And the proposed mitigations include, in general, the security protection of PCIe switches is very important in order to make sure that the platform is secure. There are two ways we can make that happen. One is through, in the general PCIe devices, we have support for secure boot or secure debug capabilities, which when enabled, we can mitigate or prevent such attacks on the PCIe devices. And our proposal is to have similar support for PCIe switches. Secondly, the host software or your host VM or your hypervisor, which is a trusted software, should also make sure that the guest VM has not access to the PCIe switch configurations and so on to generate such attacks. So that is also another way to mitigate this problem. Coming specifically to the attack scenarios, mainly the serial EEPROM programming Our proposal or the mitigation strategy here is a platform board work can be done to block the EEPROM programming after production. That way, on a shipping product, we will not be even able to go and abuse the EEPROM programming. And the second mitigation is the hardware or ROM-based recovery. This is also supported on PCIe devices, and we would propose to apply the similar thing for PCIe switches, where in case of a persistent DOS attack that Harish discussed earlier, we should be able to recover from such attack if the PCIe switch supports hardware or ROM-based recovery. In the second attack scenario, which is the TLP injector-based attack, typically a TLP injector feature should be considered a debug feature, and hence we propose to make it disabled on a production configuration. Or if at all, if you want to enable such features, it should be enabled through an authenticated mechanism with the help of secure debug. And other supportive mitigations, which may not be able to fully mitigate the attacks we discussed, but they may provide some or minimize the attack surface to some extent, are two aspects. One is the platform software or the host hypervisor should be able to configure the IOMMU protections in such a way that the PCIe switches have limited exposure to whatever the memory regions they need to, so that they don't have the privilege to access other regions. Or the PCIe standard also supports ACS, the access control services, which is also a new security capability, using which we can also configure the source validation, based on which if a rogue PCIe device tries to send the upstream transaction, the upstream requester ID will be transmitted, and the PCIe root complex will be able to verify whether it is a valid switch or device to allow the transaction or not. That way, this attack can also be mitigated. Coming to XRIOB specific mitigations, the first one, as we discussed, demonstrated in the exploit video, the malicious VF abusing its own hardware resource to cause the platform DOS can be mitigated by ensuring that the PCIe device does not transmit a uncorrectable fatal error by default. Rather, it consults the host platform configuration, especially the AER configurations, to make sure that it handles the errors appropriately. In that case, we will be able to mitigate that issue. And the second class of attacks are mainly the software-based attacks, where a malicious VF driver can take over the control of PF driver through privilege escalation or by sending some invalid parameters. So our proposal is to strengthen the PF driver security to mitigate such attacks. And we have done it on some of the products that we have evaluated already. And we would like to acknowledge our colleague, Mr. Kumar Mangipudi, who used to work with our Intel some time ago, has contributed quite a lot into the software-based vulnerability mitigation. Lastly, we would just want to share with the participants about there are other potential areas of interest. We are also interested and going to look into some of these aspects. It will be good to also get more eyes. The first one is the peer-to-peer transaction between device connected through the switches. As we know, this is also going to cause a lot of security issues and a very good topic to look at. And the second one is the memory protections and isolations for the downstream traffic. As we know, conventionally, the upstream traffic is what we are all interested about. But when we have more devices getting connected and there is a requirement to isolate the devices themselves and the switch is not configured properly, could lead to security vulnerability. So we need to assess those memory protections. And lastly, as a PCIe also providing new security features like DICE for device attestation and SPDM for secure messaging and so on, we are in the process of evaluating these protocols as well. So with that, we will conclude our presentation, and now we are open for any questions. Thank you.